ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्नस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा। सो लेट्स लुक एट द वर्स एंड देन वील गो टू द थीम ऑफ द क्लास टुडे। राज्ञो मूर्धाभिषिक्तस्य वधो ब्रह्मवदाद् गुरु तीर्थ संसेवया चामहो यह्य अंगाच्युत चेतनः। सो राज्ञो मूर्ध अभिषक्तस्य वधा, वधा मीन्स टू किल। दैट एक्चुअली द किलिंग ऑफ अ किंग हू हैज बीन सेलिब्रेटेड एज द एम्परर मूर्धाभिषिक्तस्य। सो ही हैज बीन अभिषिक्त, ही हैज बीन अभिषेक हैज बीन परफॉर्म फॉर हिम, ही हैज बीन कॉन्सेक्रेटेड नॉट जस्ट एज अ किंग बट एज द एम्परर। दैट किंग किलिंग द किंग इज ब्रह्मवधाद् गुरुः is actually worse than killing of a brahmana. Tirtha samsevaya chamho, that tirtha is holy places, samsevaya means by systematic study service, samyak rupena seva, seva is service, samsevaya chamho. So amha is sin. So this chamho can seem like the short form of the word we use, pamho. Please accept my humble obeisances. This is a completely different word, however. Cha amho. Amho is sin. So the sin of that, jahya, you'll become able to wash out, clean it away. Anga achyuta chetanaha. That anga, oh dear one, he's referring to his son, achyuta chetanaha. So in this way, by working in a mood of devotion, you will be able to free yourselves from the sin of the activity that you have done, that is killing a brahmana. So now there are many significant parts in this session. Are all of you able to see my PowerPoint here? I'll be using this PowerPoint mostly as my, you can see the PowerPoint.
No, we've seen the verse.
Oh, is it? Okay. Okay, so mostly I'll be using the PowerPoint as a whiteboard. So let me see what's happening here. Why is it not being seen? So we have here Ragyo Murdha Vishaktasya. So let's look at this one by one. Okay, let me just stop the screen share and start it once again, so that hopefully it may be seen now. Okay. So what we will do today is, we'll go section by section in the verse, and then we'll see what is happening. So let's first look at the overall context. As I said, so context is what? There are broadly three contexts to every verse in the Bhagavatam. One is the immediate conversation. And this is between, this verse is being spoken by Jamadagni to Parshuram, his son Parshuram, whom he's referring to as Anga, after the killing of Kartavir Arjuna. This is the immediate context of the verse. Now we know that the Bhagavatam is a set of nested conversations. So broadly speaking, we know two levels of nestings. One is that Shuta Goswami is speaking to Sages Naimisharanya, Shukadeva Goswami is speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. So now beyond this, so the immediate context, so we can say the broader context is that this is being, so he is giving a statement that that you have killed a king, and killing a king is a terrible thing to do. And he's explaining how terrible it is. So the broader context is Shukadeva Goswami is speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. And then the universal context is basically it is written by Vyasadeva for all of us. So Vyasadeva to all of us. So we can say every verse has these three contexts in the Bhagavatam. And the verses can be understood from any of these contexts or all of these contexts. So now let's look at the, after we look at the context of the verse, let's look at the content. The content is quite a remarkable content. It has three parts. What is it? First thing this? Ragyabhishaktasya. So killing of a consecrated king, you can say. It is worse than killing a Brahmana. Now this itself will be a significant statement. We'll explore this. Well, what is the exact implication of this is? And therefore he said that atone by not just going to holy places, but actually it is, but by serving the holy places. What is he saying? So the word is samsevaya tirtha. So he's asking that you should serve the holy places. This is what is the significant difference between these. We'll look at this. So samsevaya tirtha. And then he says, this alone is not enough. By going to the holy places and by serving the holy places, what will happen is you'll be cultivating Krishna consciousness, as Prabhupada translated as. So what is the achyuta chetasa? What is it? Achyuta chetanaha. Achyuta chetasa or achyuta chetanaha. So you'll be cultivating, achyuta is another name for Krishna, as the infallible one. So by this, you will, by going to the holy places, serving the holy places, and thus cultivating Krishna consciousness, you will be able to king. So it's interesting that, let's look at the first statement. Sometimes when we want to look at a particular statement, you know, say what happens is when somebody speaks, so analyzing the speech of somebody. So what someone is not telling can be telling. What I mean by that is that if somebody is leaving something out of the speech, that what someone is not telling can be telling. So by the telling is a play of words of telling. So first telling means speaking. And the second telling is revealing or illuminating. So for example, often people can spin the truth in a very different way depending on whom you are supporting. You know, for example, if you say, oh, that were those people, they are evil, because they ruthlessly killed 20 of our people when they were unarmed and they were unattacking and they were sleeping. That can make a person's blood curdle. But why did they do that? Oh, that's because our people had attacked them and killed 20 people like that. So basically what happens is, whenever we tell any story, whenever we tell any fact, what we are not telling can be telling. That means, when we tell something, which part of the story do we tell? Which part of it do we leave out? That can be very, very significant. So for example, Gita is spoken on the battlefield. Just before, it's not just spoken on the battlefield, it is spoken just before the war is about to start. Yet, the Gita doesn't contain a single reference to the causes of the war. Not a single reference. If Krishna's purpose was simply to get Arjuna to fight. Now, one of the easiest ways to get people to fight is to incite their emotions, to make them angry. So if Krishna, so what it implies is that Krishna, if Krishna had just wanted to get Arjuna to fight, he could have reminded, do you not remember how they tried to disrobe Draupadi in public? That would have been enough to make Arjuna's blood boil. So Krishna doesn't incite Arjuna's emotions. Rather, it's the exact opposite. Throughout, Krishna is telling Arjuna, maintain equanimity. Do not be carried away by emotions. So it's fascinating. So now what is this, if we apply this principle, what someone is not telling can be telling. What we mean by that is that when somebody leaves out, when somebody leaves out certain things, that reveals their motives, that reveals their consciousness. And it can be very significant in terms of what is their intent. So if Krishna's purpose had been simply to get Arjuna to fight, he would immediately have incited Arjuna's emotions. But he didn't do that. So Krishna's, this reveals that Krishna's purpose was to give universal wisdom, not just get things done. Not just get things done. Oh, you have to fight this war. It's a part of my plan. You just fight it. If that had been the only purpose of Krishna, he could have just done it in many different ways. So similarly, applying this principle that what someone is not telling can be telling. So what is happening over here is, in this context of the of 9.15 SB, so there is no reference at all by Jamadagni. Doesn't even refer to what the king has done. Now, yes, Parashuram has acted severely. Parashuram has killed the king. But why has he done it? There is no reference to that. Now we may say, is this not partial? No, you look at the full context. You look at what this person did, because of which I responded in this way. So why is he not referring to it at all? And we see also Parashuram is generally considered to be a very aggressive person. In fact, his very name indicates Parashuram, one who delights in fighting, delights in using his weapon of Parashu. And yet, Parashuram doesn't argue with him. Parashuram doesn't justify what he has done. He says, why don't you look at the full picture? So why is that over there? Why is that? So here, Jamadagni's purpose is to be understood. See, whenever any statement is made, there is a purpose for that statement. So now Arjuna, based on the context of the Gita, could also have been just on the context of the Mahabharata war, could have been justified in fighting. But that was not the purpose of Krishna. Krishna's purpose was not just to somehow get Arjuna to fight. It was to get give universal wisdom. So similarly, Jamadagni's purpose was to instruct or train his son in self-control. In this case, controlling his anger. Controlling his anger. So now we could go into another direction and say how Parashuram is God and God can never make any mistake. God doesn't get under control of anger. That is true. That's also another perspective of looking at it. But in this purpose, Jamadagni is thinking, he's my son and I have to train him. You cannot get angry like this. You cannot take the law in your own hands. You cannot become an activist for vigilante justice. So whenever an argument is made, it is usually made for a particular purpose. And if you don't understand the purpose, the argument itself can seem quite unreasonable. Why are you not looking at the full picture of it, the whole thing? And now, why does he have to especially train him in anger, in controlling anger? Because that is a Brahmana's duty. In the Bhagavad Gita, if we consider, it's remarkable. So what the Gita says in the Bhagavatam echoes is that virtues are both universal and contextual. What do I mean by universal and contextual? Say, for example, kindness. and helpfulness. Speak gently, speak politely with others. Help, you can say, help others. That is a universal virtue. These are virtues which everybody will appreciate. And that is true, no doubt. But at the same time, there are virtues which vary according to context. What do you mean by vary according to context? That if we consider the 18th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna talks about various virtues, the virtues he describes for Brahmanas and Kshatriyas are actually not just different, they are opposite. The virtues that he describes for the Brahmanas are that Brahmana should be forgiving, for example. And he says that for the Kshatriyas, they should never flinch from a fight. Now, in one sense, forgiving is the exact opposite. When you are forgiving, basically, what are we doing? We are avoiding a fight. So, virtues are contextual. Contextual means what is a virtue for one person may not be the virtue for the other person. And if you consider, let me share the screen once again here. We'll go to the 18th chapter overview. Here, you see this is 1842 is the virtues of a Brahmana. So, Shamo Damas Tapah Shaucham Shantir Arjavam Evacha Jnanam Vijnanam Astikyam Brahma Karma Subhavajam. So, he's talking about Shama, controlling the senses, controlling the mind. Shanti. Now, Shanti can be translated as peacefulness, and it can be translated as tolerance, it can be translated as forgiveness. To maintain the peace. So, how do we maintain the peace? When others provoke us, we tolerate them. When others even anger or injure us, we forgive them. So, Shanti is a virtue of Brahma Karma Sabhavajam, of the Brahmanas. But in contrast, is the next verse, 1843, what is the virtue of a Kshatriya? Yuddhe chapya apalayanam. That means whenever there is a fight, yuddhe is fight. Palayana means to flee, to turn away, to flinch. Apalayanam, that don't turn away from a fight, don't flee from a fight. That means whenever that you Kshatriya should be ready to fight. So there are different virtues for different people. Now, isn't forgiveness is a virtue for everyone? Isn't tolerance and peacefulness required for everyone? On the other hand, doesn't everyone have to stand for their principles at times? And everyone is required to fight sometimes when it's required. Yuddhe chapya palayanam. So we can say here, yes, it's true. Forgiveness is primarily a Brahminical virtue. I'll explain. And then fighting the just war or fighting for justice, that is a Kshatriya virtue. Fighting for a just cause, instead of just for the religious Christian connotation, fighting for a just cause, the cause of justice, we could say, that is a Kshatriya virtue. Now, does that mean that Brahmanas should be fighting for a just cause? Yes, Brahmanas also fight for a just cause, but they do not fight by taking up weapons. So, and similarly, Kshatriyas are also required to be forgiving, but Kshatriyas cannot be defined by their forgiveness. Why? Because Kshatriyas have to maintain the rule of law. Kshatriyas have to maintain order. If tomorrow the Supreme Court, the courts of the country decide, we'll be forgiving. And whoever, whatever crime has been committed, will forgive all the criminals and release them into mainstream society. Well, that will be devastating because criminals are, they're not likely to reform. Many of them will just take misadvantage of this. So forgiveness is a vital individual virtue, but it can't be a standard state policy. It can't be a standard state policy. Anytime police arrest someone and they come in front of the judge, we are forgiving, let's forgive you today. Well, no, from an individual's person, especially Brahmanas, who have detached them from the world, who are not possessive, it's important for them to forgive. So, on the other hand, for a Kshatriya, if they adopt forgiveness as a universal state policy, a standard state policy, there'll be chaos in society. So why are we discussing this over here? Here, in some ways, the whole purpose, if you want to consider Jamadagni's purpose over here is to train his Brahmana son to act in a Brahmana way, not a Kshatriya way. So, yes, there are Kshatriyas who are meant to do Kshatriya activities, and there are Brahmanas who are meant to do Brahmana activities. That's why if we, sometimes in movies, so movies may romanticize or dramatize, may romanticize vigilante justice. But if everybody at an individual level starts taking the law into their hands, and in real life it can lead to chaos, because you know it's not so easy to, it can lead to chaos because in real life it's very difficult to determine who is really wrong, who is really right. We have to have a proper hearing. We have to have let both sides present the case of the story. If one person says, you know, this person is wrong, let's punish them, it can lead to chaos. So now, in one sense, in terms of the broader story of Parshuram, this is going to serve a vital purpose. That if Parshuram had just been a short-tempered person who had given in to his anger, he might not have obeyed his father. And he might have rebelled against his father. But what is happening through these instructions? So Jamadagni's instruction, if you want to consider them in the context of the larger story, they reveal Parshuram's character. So is this just a short-tempered person who got angry? No. See, on one side, rather than simply defending, you know, I didn't do wrong, I was provoked. And it was not just I was provoked, he was threatening you, he was attacking you. That's why I did this. But no. So Parshuram does the atones for his actions. But on the other hand, there is no description of atonement by Kartivirajuna's side, by the Kshatriya side. The Kshatriyas, on the other hand, they just continue on and they become more brazen and they attack again. And that is when Parshuram realizes that it is not just a case of one person being corrupt. It is the rot stems throughout the Kshatriya class. That we will discuss in tomorrow's session when we come to it. But at this stage, let's focus on this particular instruction. So Jamadagni is giving this instruction and Parshuram is following this instruction. It establishes a very, very important point. The point that, actually speaking, it is not Parshuram simply being short-tempered. Parshuram's character is being built through this story. That he didn't aggressively defend himself, he atoned. But the Kshatriyas kept doing worse. And then he was justified in doing what he did. This is a broader context. Now, let's look at the instruction itself. If you look at the content of the instruction, the first point, I said there are 3 points in this. First, he's saying is, consecrated king, abhishikta, ragyo abhishiktasya, that killing a consecrated king is worse than killing a brahmana. Now, is that really true? Generally speaking, a brahmana's killing is considered to be the worst of killings in traditional society. There is no crime which is considered to be as bad as killing a brahmana. So, why is he saying that this is worse than brahmahato, gurum? It's worse than that. So again, there is a contextual emphasis in every instruction, in every statement. So is this an absolute statement? So for example, in the Ramayana, when Sugriv has promised Ram that you help me gain my kingdom and my wife, and I will help you gain your wife. I'll help you gain your consort. And then the 4 years or 4 months of rainy season start, and Sugriv gets lost in revelry in the kingdom, and he forgets his promise. So at that time, Lakshman goes to Sugriv and he says, he makes a very striking statement over there. He says, ingratitude is the worst of sins. Ingratitude is the worst of sins. Now, is it really? So is, say for example, Sugriva's forgetting his promise to Ram, is it a worse sin than Ravan's having abducted Sita? Then Ravan's having violated so many women across the universe in the past? Is really that the worst of sins? No. It is in context. In the context of a particular situation, sometimes there is a contextual emphasis. And nowadays, when we present statements, we always are expected to qualify the statements. So for example, we may say that don't make blanket statements about anyone, any group of people, any kind of blanket statements we are told to avoid. Why? Because those may be taken as absolutes by people. But in the Vedic context, people were, in the past, people were aware of context sensitivity. In fact, if you consider, context sensitivity is, let's put it this way, the context sensitivity, it permeates the entire Vedic ethos itself. That means what is being spoken is important, but to whom is it being spoken is even more important. What is being spoken is important, but to whom is it being spoken? Why is it? It is more important because, say for example, the Vedic context is so broad that there are verses describing and prescribing both. And this is how it is done, and this is what you should do. Prescribing worship of deities other than Vishnu Krishna. So, just a fortnight ago in India, there was a Ganesh Puja, which is a big festival in India. Lord Ganesh is worshipped. And there are scriptural verses for somebody who wants to consider Ganesh to be supreme also. So you may say, why does the scripture tell this? It's context sensitivity. That means if for people at a particular level of consciousness, that is what elevates them upward, then that is the most important thing. It is not that every statement has to necessarily give the absolute truth. What is important is that the statement be spoken which elevate the person from where they are to the next level. So we could say, more important than speaking the absolute truth is speaking that which elevates a person toward the absolute truth. So if somebody is not at a level where they can actually appreciate the ultimate reality, if they cannot really worship Krishna, the Bhagavatam or the Vedic context doesn't say 1-0. You can't worship Krishna, you have to go to hell. No. If you can't worship Krishna, okay, what is your psychology? What is your consciousness? What is the level at which you are at? And which deity can you be attracted to? And accordingly, you will be presented, or that person will be attracted towards, by the indwelling super soul, toward that particular deity whom they can connect with, whom they can worship. And that's how they can get elevated. And we see this even in Bhagavatam itself, in 4.9, basically the Dhruva pastime. What happens there over there is, Narad Muni Narad Muni doesn't give him the instruction of pure devotional service. Narad Muni sees, Narad Muni mentions that to him, be equipoised, I mean, honor and dishonor. And when he can't do that, he tells him, fine, if you can't do that, then I will give an instruction by which you worship Lord Hari and you will get the kingdom. So Narad Muni to Dhruva, when Dhruva says, you know, this instruction doesn't work for me, he says, be equipoised. Honor and dishonor just illusory constructs because of the ego. He says, I can't accept this. So then it's okay, that's fine. I'll give you, okay, you are feeling hurt right now and your primary concern is how can you get a kingdom? Okay, that's what I'll help you attain. So that is what is done over here. So similarly, from that perspective, this particular statement which we are evaluating, what is the statement? That killing a brahmana, killing a consecrated king is worse than killing a brahmana. This is not necessary. It's not necessarily a universal truth. It is a statement to elevate Parshuram. Now, at one level, you can say Parshuram is already liberated, so there's no point to elevate him. But he's playing a role. Avatar means he plays the role of a human being to elevate Parshuram. Now, as a Parshuram, as a Brahmana, he respects Brahmanas. And later on in the Mahabharata, we will see that when he respects Brahmana so much, and although he has given up his weapons and he said, I will not be fighting anymore. But when a Brahmana requests him, please fight for the sake of Amba, then he picks up the weapons and he challenges Bhishma at that time. And they have a fight over there. So Parshuram has deep respect. It is using his deep respect for Brahmanas to drive home the seriousness of his rash action. The seriousness of his rash action. That literally, is it that killing any person, suppose somebody is a tyrant is on the throne, and kill that tyrant, then is that worse than killing a brahmana? Obviously not. If you see in the Bhagavatam itself, you will see exceptions where the brahmanas themselves go and kill a king. And that too, we can say the Bhagavatam, non-universality of this particular instruction. So if you can see, what is the instruction we are talking about? The instruction that killing a king is worse than killing a brahmana. So if you can say non-illustrated, what happens is the brahmanas themselves kill Veda. So if you see 4c, 4 point, it's 13, 14 in the Bhagavatam. What happens is it's described how the brahmanas kill Veda. So are they committing a sin worse than killing a brahmana? No, not at all. So if now they themselves had consecrated Veena as a king and yet they kill him because he's brutal. So overall, he's so brutal that his being a king would be a great threat to society. And that's why he has to be killed. He has to be destroyed. So here, this statement that you have to be, that what you did is an extremely serious crime. That seriousness of the crime is being illustrated by conveying, by comparing it with another heinous crime, that is a killing of a brahmana. So it's not an absolute universal statement. It is a contextual statement for a particular purpose. So if we don't understand the universality, if we don't understand the contextuality of the statements, you know, it can lead to catastrophic consequences at times. Nowadays with respect to social media, now what happens is that anybody can just take any controversial subject and search for Prabhupada's quotes on that subject. And then now Prabhupada has written millions and millions of words. From what I last counted, we have Prabhupada's Vani, we have around 14 million words of Prabhupada. His written words, his spoken and transcribed words, and his letters, 14 million. It's not a small amount. There are 14 million words. And out of which he may have spoken maybe 140 words on one subject. But by one Google search, what happens is, out of 14 million words spoken by, now spoken, 40 million is approximation, different counts may be used for different things, by Srila Prabhupada, you know, sometimes somebody might just quote, Prabhupada made five statements. So there are 140 words, five statements. 140 words may be taken out and absolutized. This is what Prabhupada said about this issue. No, we have to see, okay, in what context Prabhupada spoke it? Why did he speak it? And you know, this can lead to, if it is not understood, it can lead to tragedy, not just a misrepresentation of Prabhupada. It has to be very, very carefully understood. When Srila Prabhupada was on the planet and he was on a morning walk with disciples, and Prabhupada quoted up the pastime of how Chota Haridas, because he, despite being in the renounced order, glanced inappropriately, or at least was perceived to have glanced inappropriately at a woman. And because of that, eventually he ended up ending his life. And Prabhupada said that is what is expected of a sannyasi who commits wrong, who commits sexual wrongs. So now there's a prominent leader in our movement who heard that. He ended up ending his life accordingly. And just a few minutes later, devotees asked Prabhupada, do you want us to do this? He said, no, absolutely not. He says, that is Lord Chaitanya. He is the Supreme Lord, and I cannot demand that from you. I need all of you. So just that few minutes, it was just a few minutes later, the context was not given, the qualification was not given, and it led to the death of one of the prominent leaders of our movement at that time. So now we have to understand that it is not just a matter of casual misunderstanding. So neglecting context can lead not just to, it can lead to, it's not just a matter of casual misunderstanding or misrepresentation. Oh, you know, I thought this was like this, or misrepresentation. It's not just casual misunderstanding or misrepresentation, but all, even catastrophic personal or social consequences can be there. Personal or institutional consequences can be there. That's why whenever we see any statement, we have to look at the context. I'll conclude with a three-point principle. What does it mean, look at context? I'll conclude with this point over there. And appreciating context. What does it mean? And broadly say three things it means. Are we appreciating context? You know, how do we appreciate the context? So you could put it, ask yourself three questions. So three questions for appreciating the context. So first is, what did this statement mean in its original context? That means in the scripture, what does the statement mean? Then, what is the context-independent principle conveyed through this statement? And lastly, how does that principle apply in today's context or my context? So, to the extent we can ask these questions, to that extent we will get a proper understanding. So what did this statement mean in its original context? If we go back to either of the statement, we go back to the Prabhupada's statement about Lord Chaitanya's actions vis-a-vis, it was not Lord Chaitanya's actions, but it's Chota Haridas' actions specifically. Yeah, okay, that was a particular action at a particular time. There are not many historical records of people actually doing like that. But the context independent principle is that be strict. If somebody is in a particular ashram, they have to follow the rules of that ashram strictly. That strictness in following principles, that is the important thing. Now, how do that principle apply in today's context? Prabhupada applied it very differently. Prabhupada took a much more forgiving attitude. Prabhupada even, we could say, immortalized forgiveness by putting it in his purport in the 8th canto. In the Gajendra pastime, he said that Gajendra could not fight in the water. If he had been in the land, he could have been able to fight the crocodile better. Similarly, it says if we are in an area where we are in a place where we can't fight properly against the forces of illusion, don't give up the fight, don't cave in. Move to another area and fight from there. And Prabhupada applied that with respect to ashram. We can apply that with respect to service. We can apply that with respect to relationships. We can apply that with respect to various things in our life. So absolutizing statements is not only misleading, it can be devastating. And the statement over here contains a universal principle. The universal principle is that violence, especially violence against the head of the state, shouldn't be done indiscriminately by people who think that they are right. We'll talk about the implications further in the context in our session tomorrow. At this stage, I would like to summarize. Broadly, today we discussed about three main points. First was, we looked at the context of this particular verse, that this verse is saying that killing a Brahmana, killing a Kshatriya, especially a consecrated king, is worse than killing a Brahmana. And therefore, you should perform atonement by serving the holy places and becoming Krishna conscious. And then in that context, we discussed that what is left out. What is left out is he's not talking about the unfairness or the brutality or the unreasonability, the abuse of power of the king over here. What someone is not telling can be telling. So just as Krishna doesn't talk about the contextual injustices the Pandavas have been subjected to, similarly, here, Jamadagni doesn't talk about what led Parshuram to the violence. Why is that? Because his focus is on primarily on training Parshuram in forgiveness, in self-mastery, not giving into anger. And Parshuram's willingness to do atonement after that, even though he could have justified and countered, that shows that he was ready to control his anger. And later when he explored his anger, that is shown to be not just an impulsive bout of anger, but it was somebody who had the capacity for disciplining himself, but he saw a justified cause. That's why he got angry. The second point we discussed was about, is the statement literal that killing a Kshatriya, killing a king is worse than killing a Brahmana? Well, no. The point here is that virtues are context specific also. A Brahmana's primary virtue is forgiveness. It's very important as an individual virtue for everyone, not just Brahmanas. But forgiveness cannot be a default state policy. Kings have to establish justice. And that's why sometimes they may have to confront, including by confront in a war. So because Parshuram is a Brahmana, so for him, he is being told, you shouldn't have acted like this. So that is a specific purpose. And then to emphasize, because he had deep respect for Brahminical culture and for Brahmanas, so to drive home the gravity of his actions, what is being told, your killing was worse than killing a Brahmana. And then finally, discuss how without context, there can be not just minor misrepresentations, but there can be catastrophic individual or social consequences if context is neglected. And to understand a statement in context means what? We look at the whole story or the whole passage to see what does it mean in its original context. Then what is the principle independent of the context? And lastly, how does that principle apply in today's context? In this way, by context sensitivity, we can learn and we can apply scripture in a way that actually helps people, helps ourselves and others come closer to the ultimate reality, come closer to the absolute truth. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Chaitanya Prabhu. Wonderful presentation. We're kind of over time, but let's see if devotees have any comments or questions.
Okay, now this question, can we, Karthik Prabhu, if you are going to be there tomorrow, since we are over time, we can take this question tomorrow also. You let me know. And how do you want to go ahead?
Let's take this question.
Okay. So, generally speaking, if you want to understand whether in the particular context forgiveness is what is required or something else is required, broadly speaking, my understanding would be look at three things. You know, that look at every Kshatriya that expected to forgive. It's not that forgiveness is undesirable, not at all. But the point is that whom to forgive, when to forgive. So look at the overall character of a person, not just that particular action. Look at the overall character of the person. And that's why quite often when a person is to be tried in court, then you look at whether that person has a past criminal record, that is somebody ready to give a character certificate for that person, and who is the person giving the character certificate. So if they give a character certificate, okay, you trust this person, you can, okay, then that's an important factor to consider. So basically, don't just look at that one action, look at the overall life or pattern of life of that person. That would be one important thing. Then another point is that we also have to look at that person's attitude toward that wrongdoing. So that means, does that person really repent what they have done? Or are they justifying it? Are they, if they are justifying it, then that's also something which has to be, which indicates us that there is something wrong over there. Then another point is that we have to look at the circumstances. Sometimes some extremely provocative circumstances can bring the bad even out of a good person. So we have to look at the extenuating circumstances at times. And I think one of the biggest things would be premeditation. So premeditation means, is that person done something which like that before also, or is it the first time they're doing it? So is it simply impulsive that in the heat of the moment they did it, or was there some plan in doing it? So, and it's not, if we just look at overall a person and how they have acted, it's relatively easy to make out that was this premeditated. Generally premeditated means a lot of balls have to be juggled together. That a lot of balls have to be juggled together. Otherwise, it cannot get done. So broadly, four things, I like to use the acronym PARE over here. P-A-R-E, PARE means premeditation, attitude, repetition and extremity. How extreme is it? How much is it different from that person's usual actions? So is that crime premeditated? What is their attitude? Are they justifying it or are they acknowledging their mistake? Is it something which is repeated? And if we consider the overall patterns of their character, then we understand that is it something which is extreme, completely different from the way they normally are and the way normally act, or is it something which is something typical of that person? So that way, broadly, we can understand. Administering justice is not a very easy task. It's not just, it has been careful consideration and training is required. Otherwise, we might just arrive at we might just do investigation to confirm the judgment that we already arrived at. We consider, you know, we all have certain likes or dislikes for some people. We may try to avoid being biased, but we all have certain likes or dislikes. And sometimes what happens is when some things happen, we just use those, our default attitude or default judgment will be towards the person who we like. Oh, that person must be right. And the person whom we dislike is wrong. So this can be applied from both principles. One is that, you know, we try to, as individuals, we try to become more and more aware of our biases. And the other is that from as individuals who might be subjected to judgment in future by others, we try our best to avoid creating enemies. We try to avoid doing things which will unnecessarily alienate or anger others. Okay. So thank you very much. And we will continue in tomorrow's session. And tomorrow's session broadly will be discussing the theme of how Parshuram performed atonement and how Parshuram's eventual violence was justified and not indiscriminate. And in that context, we'll discuss, broadly speaking, the idea of religious violence also, that there's religion inside violence and there seems to be a lot of violence in the epics. So we'll discuss broadly those three themes: Parshuram's atonement, then the justification, the reasoning for his sufficient eventual violence, and religious violence at large. Thank you very much. Granthraj, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.